Ladies and gentlemen, I, Shri Guru Prasad, on behalf of Extramural Lectures IIT Madras, welcome you all to the fourth EML lecture of this semester. The essence of democracy lies in the participation of people in the decision-making as well as its execution. With a country as huge as India and with its varied cultural and linguistic heritages, this process is often difficult. The rise of technology, however, has brought about a sea change in this regard. To talk about this and much more, we are honored to have our host, Shri Arvind Gupta, today. A pioneer in digital technology, he has founded and successfully exited from two tech startups, as well as he was the man behind bringing technology into electoral campaigns. He was the recipient of Eisenhower Global Fellowship for Innovation in the year 2014. He is currently the CEO of MyGov Portal, which aims to bring governance to the tips of the fingertips of the citizens. I would request Preeti ma'am to do the honors. Welcome the speaker with the fruit basket. I now welcome Mr. Arvind Gupta to take the stage.
Well, we are struggling with technology to make the presentation come live there. Do you think we have some hope of this becoming live? Okay. Murphy's Law, right? Oh, it works. Okay. As the student who was interviewing me, I wear many hats, and currently I am the head of one of the big digital, not portals, but platforms of the government, MyGov. And we'll talk about MyGov and how does it fit into the whole digital infrastructure of the country. But I'm assuming most of you are B.Tech, M.Tech, dual degree, PhD students here, right? And let me know if I'm speaking too fast, too slow. And I know we need to keep some time. It's 5:52 by this clock. So we'll probably do it for about 40 minutes, 45 minutes, and question answers. Is that okay with everybody? Right? Yes, no?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I get energy if you keep saying something, even if it's a wrong answer. I am also an adjunct professor, so I teach a lot. So if you keep telling me that something, I'll keep asking you. So it's okay that I ask you a lot of questions, right? That's fair, okay. So thank you for having me, Professor Preeti. She's globally famous from the CBS 60 program that I was part of the team that during Pan-IIT early days, who knew that's happening, so. It's been a very fruitful visit so far to the IIT Madras campus. We had MOU signing with the director and dean on doing collaborative research / internships with students out here. I already took a class with Professor Venkatesh's students, and I ended up meeting a professors of mine from the US. Such a coincidence, huh? 1.3 billion people, and you end up meeting a professor of yours from the US in IIT Madras canteen, right? So such a small world. From Urbana-Champaign, he used to be he's professor of mechanical engineering there. So with that, let me start off by asking you something. And I asked this question before, so if anybody attended this before, please excuse me. Very simple question. All of you are in your initial stages of your learning. I am still in my advanced stages of learning, but still it's not stopped. My question to you is, and we'll start with this, if any of you are quizzers out there, it will be fun for you. In 10 years ago, 17 September 2008, what happened? Anybody remember? 17 September 2008, what happened? Somebody said it. Lehman Brothers. You were not there in the morning class. You were there, right? This is called cheating. So he has given it away. And why I'm saying this is very important. Lehman Brothers happened 2008, September 17, global financial crisis. Probably the biggest financial crisis after the dot-com bust, but still bigger than that because it was core crisis. It was not an overvaluation crisis after the Great Depression of 1930s. Why is this important? Why was that date important? Because that is set as a benchmark in the global industry when things completely turned. That was an inflection point in our current economy. We don't know how long the current economy is going to last globally. Because that point in time, people thought Alibaba was a fairy tale. Amazon was a crazy guy who had taken all his bag and baggage and drove in a car from New York to Seattle. Probably worth a couple of billion dollars then, nothing more. Right? Apple was big. Apple was still big, but not the biggest. What were, and you don't answer. What were the top five companies then? What were the top five companies then? Microsoft is one, yes. What else? Facebook? No. 2008, how many of you had heard of Facebook? I had not heard of it. Walmart? Nope. Walmart is still not the top five valuable, by the way. It is the biggest by size, by revenue. It does a lot of sales, but not value. I'm asking by value. Not Google. Not IBM. Professor? Which one?
Banks.
One of the banks was Citibank, probably. Yeah, very good. ExxonMobil. Good. You're on the right track now. The companies, the top companies in the world were dominated by energy and banking companies. Microsoft being the only exception. What is the state today, 10 years? Because all of these companies that we are talking about, a lot of these companies that you and me use these days didn't exist in 2008. When did Google acquire Android? You know Google acquire Android, by the way. It is not a homegrown product. How many of you know this? Around that time, 2009-10, 10 years broadly, had just acquired Android, right? The first iPhone has probably just come out. Uber didn't exist, right? Instagram, nobody knew. And yes, the top companies in the 10 years have completely turned. The message I'm giving friends is the business cycles of the world today are compressed from 30 to 40 years to about 10 years. The companies that did not exist in 2008 or were relatively unknown, and the big bosses of 2008, from that inflection point, have become also runs. And who are the big bosses today? Which is the most valuable company on the planet today? Number one, Apple. Number two, Amazon. Number three, Google, Alphabet. Number four, probably Facebook, Microsoft. And then comes the Chinese. Don't ignore those. Alibaba, Tencent. Have you heard of Tencent? What does Tencent make? Guys, please do research. Go to your internet today and learn what Tencent does. I cannot talk more about Tencent. Believe me, it is a remarkable company, and I'll give you some examples. Tencent makes a small platform called WeChat. Okay. And I'll tell you why I'm talking about this. Facebook, Apple, Google, Amazon, Microsoft from the US, Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent from China. Eight big companies, big platforms of the world. Probably control every single person in this room, including me, are a consumer of maybe two or three of these products. Nobody in this room can raise their hand and tell me they don't use one of these products. Can anybody say that? Not a single person. And that is the power these platforms have on all of us. They know, control us completely because of their products, their innovation. No giving that away. What is the counter to that? And that is leading into what we are trying to do with creation of the digital infrastructure in a digitally empowered India. They're doing a great job, let it happen. What is our concern? Our concern is that in India we realized that couple of things, that they don't solve the core issues, the problems that face our country. having Facebook is good, having WhatsApp is good, but does it solve problems of governance? Does it solve problems of financial inclusion? Does it solve problems of government systems, citizen participation, democracy? Probably not. It is one part of it, not very comprehensive. What about issues of national security? What about issues of sovereignty? What about citizens of citizen safety? There are a lot of these issues. And not having control on your own destiny in the long run is going to be very risky. So about 7 years ago, the government, as a country, we embarked upon very ambitious plans to build our own digital infrastructure. These platforms that we are building in our country are competing with the best in the world. And that's one thing I want to talk about, and why that open innovation that we are doing has been the core building block of governance, of financial inclusion, of democratic processes, many more. The second biggest issue was, India's societal challenge also includes doing transactions at a cost that we cannot afford. The US transaction models we can't afford. Simple example is, 44% of Americans own an iPhone. 1.2% of Indians own an iPhone. The upper strata. Can everybody own a phone in India? Right? Internet average cost globally, and especially if you compare it again with the US, access cost is $40, $35 on an average a month. That's 2,000 rupees a month. Most of India cannot afford that kind of internet access. So the message I'm giving friends is the cost structures in India need to be really rethought. And if you use technology, especially technology which is core, not built and made in India, our transaction costs go for a toss. The classic case I give is payments. All of you have payment, some debit card? Debit card, credit card, yes, no? Do you know how the debit card works? What is the purpose of a debit card? Debit card, by the virtue of being called a debit card, takes out money from one bank account and typically gives money to a second bank account. So for anybody from computer science here, computer science, double E, simple computer science, one person there. Simple transaction. Taking one entry out of your banking system and giving credit to the other guy. It's 100 rupees coming here, 100 rupees going there. But when you use a debit card, which is powered by one of the foreign networks, right? You know, you end up losing how much money? So if you give 100 rupees to a merchant, does he get 100 rupees? How much does he or she get? 98 rupees, typically. 2% gone. For what? That's a lot. Don't you think that's a lot when that poor merchant's margin is 5-7%, 8%? 25% of that is gone. If my margin was 8%, out of that 2 rupees is gone. I was making 8 rupees on the whole transaction. 2 rupees I have taken away and given to vapor. That's why they used to charge you 102 rupees. Said, I'm not going to receive your debit card. That's a lot of transaction fees for doing debit and credit entries. Credit card is separate, but debit card is taking money out of my bank and giving it to somebody else. Now, but globally, this has been working. The only country which challenged it before India was China. They built their own system. They said, we can't survive on this. This 2% model is very high. Everybody else in the world is paying rent, I call it rent seeking, to these two or three companies. And you know all of these two or three companies. You can take out your debit cards, Visa, MasterCard, American Express. And this only does not apply to debit card transactions or in point of sale, but also on ATM. They make money everywhere. When you withdraw money from the ATM, the bank pays on your behalf, by the way. Why am I telling you this use case? It's important to understand the context of India. And I, as my introduction would have said, I've worn many hats from being the cutting edge of technology. I was part of the team at UIUC, at Urbana-Champaign Computer Science Department, that built the world's first browser. From there to Silicon Valley, many startups. Some I've exited already successfully. That's why I've kind of semi-retired in doing all this. And I'm probably the running a startup inside the government as a startup person. First experiment, double experiment of its kind. Why am I telling you this? Because in the context of India, building our own digital infrastructure, which has the ability to have control over our own destiny, has been very important. And so far, we did not. We were dependent on everything on somebody else. And if you jutta pokes it with the story of 2008 and 18, why the reason I, can you come to the first slide, please? I gave you the example of the top companies in the world. What was the motivation behind that? That in a very short span of time, something that used to take 30 years for businesses to become and become so big, the time has squeezed to 7 to 10 years now. But there is a lesson there, that because the time has squeezed so to lesser time, to a lesser duration, there is hope for all of us. We can leapfrog. If you have the right vision, you can leapfrog. And that's exactly what India did. We have leapfrogged from being somebody who was not aware of this world to somebody who's controlling this world. The platforms I talked about, Microsoft, Facebook, Amazon, Google, and Apple, the five companies from the US, top five companies, right? You have to remember that. Faga plus Microsoft. Faga is Facebook, Apple, Google, Alphabet, Amazon. Faga. Facebook, Apple, Google, Amazon, plus Microsoft, plus BAT from China, Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent. Eight companies have billion plus users, and probably all of them feature in the top 10 companies of the world today as market cap. The only country, the only platform in the world which is challenging them is the India's platform. Don't go by the Aadhaar logo there. It's Digital India. It's our own platform. I've just symbolically given that as a platform. It is the biggest platform in the world, not owned by any private company, owned by the government, owned by the people of the country. And this is the platform I wanted to share with you today, because you have to understand, while we have all heard bits and pieces of it, what game changing we have done with this, all of us combined. This is game changing that has happened and built a platform. The last sleepless nights, I would say, very, very proudly, to all these other platforms, everybody else. Right? Today, India is the only country in the world, which is a completely integrated. Come to the next slide, please. Identity, KYC, know your customer, paperless, and payments platform. Completely integrated. You know this? Have you ever used this? Who has used this? Beam, okay, what else? Phone Pay, what else? Our flight is 15 minutes late, so we have Mr. Nipun. SMS alerts are coming on the flight, 15 minutes late. Okay, what else? Beam, Google, what else? Paytm, okay. WhatsApp, WhatsApp payments. You're missing the big picture. You're seeing the small ones. All of you verified your phone connections. Earlier, how you used to do it? How many of you have Jio phone connections? All of you have used this. Not for making a payment, actually verifying your identity paperlessly. How did you do that? Aadhaar is an identity number. You verified yourself biometrically, and you did what is called a KYC. First is authentication, that's you. What's your name? Suraj Dev authenticated, this is Suraj Dev. Then second time you authenticated yourself and you shared the consent for saying I am ready to share my KYC documents, which is your proof of address, which earlier used to give a photocopy, electronically. You have done this. And guess not only you, 11 crore people in India signed up on Jio in 170 days, faster than Facebook, faster than Google, by the way. No, do the maths. You are all JEE qualified, right? You can do the maths. 11 crore divided by 170 days divided by 24 hours. We'll find out who got 110 million faster, whether it was Facebook or whether it was Jio. But who enabled Jio to happen and why did it happen? Somebody asked me this question before. What was the government's role in that? No way. It was a fair game. Anybody could do it. But they were the first probably leaders to do it because earlier it used to be a paper process. Somebody would make you fill a form. You would also take a paper copy or your servant's driving license copy. Right? That is how you gamed the system. Right? Everybody did that, to be very frank. Ya Bahadur ek lekar aa bhai. Aisa hota tha na ki bhai ek lekar aa ja bhai ek mera bhi connection lekar aa ja. Sorry, speaking in Hindi. But it's all gone now. You have to do it yourself. And it's instantaneous. You give KYC done. Digital completely. But what did it do? Why did Jio, why is the Jio case study I'm mentioning to you very important? Because it brought down the customer acquisition cost. The cost of doing the paper process, human BS, was $25, approximately 1500. Couldn't have offered it for free, and they couldn't have done it at that scale. Imagine 11 crore paper applications sitting in some stack somewhere. You couldn't have done it in such a short time. They did it completely paperlessly, totally digitally, and at what cost? Approximately $1, 25 versus 1. That's why they could offer you that service at such a ridiculously low price in the initial months, but at scale. But what was behind it was this. The identity, the KYC. Who stored your KYC? The DigiLocker. That's India's answer to Dropbox, by the way. Or box.com. Identity. That's Aadhaar. We may think it's Aadhaar, but it's identity authentication system. I ask this question, when you buy a blank phone, a new Android phone today, what happens? How do you authenticate yourself? Through a Google account. Why? Do you have a choice? You don't have a choice. If I am a startup today, I can create authentication through a Aadhaar-based identity system. Probably better. I'm not going to give all my credentials away to Google. But we didn't have a choice then, right? So this is identity system is authentication system is competing with the Google Auth system. For those that semi-tech guys would be getting this, it's very, very critical. So today there are many people in across who have no clue about using Google. But they have to sign up. Because that's the only way the Play Store or whatever it's called, the Google App Store will work, Play Store. That's it, there's no other way. That's how they get you in that Google world. You have an email address, you start receiving emails, they start sending you advertisements, you're hooked on to the system. Right? But today we have the biggest identity system in the world. 1.2 billion people are using this. And it's very, very low cost. It's made in India. Google spent $100 billion to get to a billion users. India spent total of 10,000 crores, $1.5 billion. And it's today an infrastructure. And we can keep debating the privacy and all. We should, because we have to keep improving it. But as of today, as a technology infrastructure, yesterday what did get launched? What got launched yesterday? The Ayushman Bharat. Ayushman Bharat. What do you think it's going to use? At this scale, it's going to use what is called India Stack. Identity, paperless payments, all, and with your mobile number connected to it. Everything. Interconnected. This is the trinity which is called the India Stack. The Aadhaar Stack. Whatever word you name you want to use it. Fondly called the India Stack. No country in the world, friends, has this scale digital infrastructure built at a cost that we have and reach that we have. And not owned by one private company. It's owned by the common good of India. This is groundbreaking. Absolutely groundbreaking. Now, you guys talked about payments. Let me ask you a question about payments. 2% debit card fees, right? How complex is payments if you think about it as email? In email, what do? You send an email from to, with an email address from to email address. You put a subject line. You put some text in it. That's your email text. And email goes from one system to another. You know, that is India's payment system. That's the backbone of India's payment system. Do you know you all have a payment address? What's your payment address? Yes, that's one option. Or your Aadhaar number at the rate UPI. Or your Aadhaar number at the rate of your ICICI bank or your HDFC bank. The at the rate bank, before that your identifier. That's your email address. It's the SMTP world applied to payments. Nobody's ever done this. We actually used the MTE protocol within the HTTP protocol to implement it. Going back to my classes of 1992. That's the beauty of it, simplification. That's why it works very beautifully at a very low cost. You don't need expensive switching. It goes to a gateway. The gateway says, okay, this at the rate sign belongs to ICICI Bank. Go there, give them the credit. It actually works like that. Simple design, applied, computer science algorithms, applied, done, solved. Existing protocols. What happens because of that? You have the cheapest, fastest, most scalable payment system in the world. In the world, by the way. In demonetization month, November 2016, some of you may remember, this payment system used to do 100,000 transactions. Means 1 lakh transactions a month. Guess how much transactions this payment system did last month? Prizes for guessing. How much? Be ambitious. Guess. 12 crores. Okay. Guess again. Nein, itna bhi nahi. 31 crores. 310 million. From 1 lakh at 100,000 to 31 million. 0.1 million. To 31 million, 310 times over in 20 months. No payment system has scaled at that speed. And we always thought Indian infrastructure doesn't hold good. Who has made this? We do over 30 million authentications using Aadhaar a day. 30 million a day, by the way. Not Google, not Facebook. Only two people have authentication system. If you log on to, or maybe LinkedIn also has, I don't know. But when you log on to sites, it says log in using Google, log in using Facebook, or create your own, right? Now actually there's an option called create Aadhaar. And you know, you and me don't use it. The rural population uses that because all of India's digital infrastructure, that's the third thing. Scale, frugality, but what is the third thing? It's available in all languages, one. Two, it's available in assisted mode. Means if I don't know how to do, somebody else can help me do it. Three, it's available on non-internet infrastructure. And this is the next quiz question coming to you. And fourth, it's available on voice, in works. Voice, it is work in progress. Do you know all of these transactions you can do on a non-smartphone, non-internet connection? Okay, try again. Who said this? You deserve a round of applause, please, for him. Not many people know this because we are digital natives, right? What's your name, my friend? Amog. Why this is important is because we are all digital natives. We have smartphones, we have apps, we have hundreds of apps actually. Candy bar phone, it costs $500. They still need to do the transaction. And they're the ones with the real need because they don't have a bank next door. How do they do this, Amok? Let's try it, friends. Let's see whether he's lying. Take out your phones. Don't be afraid. You all can. He's speaking my language. Maybe you should come over here.
Need to see his face.
Yeah. Get up. Very good. Amog, where are you from?
Maharashtra.
Very good. What he's saying is very good, because I've done the demonstration like that. People thought I'm fooling. So I said, turn off the internet and still do it. But try this. Go to your dialing screen, which we never use these days, the keypads. And dial *99#. Something will happen. You'll see something saying, choose your language or same bank or something. Your whole Bheem application, your whole bank is right there, by the way. Your whole bank, same transaction that you can do on a smartphone or on the online system, you can actually do it right here. Do you realize that? Half of India still does not have an internet connection. Half of India still does not have an internet connection. Our systems are made that they work at this lowest common denominator. That's the design principle. It works in all languages. Shri works in assisted mode, and I'll explain what that is. And fourth, we are making it voice enabled. That's the new technology we are building. This is the thing that we all need to be proud of. Every single Indian has built this, not a Microsoft or a Google. 1.2, 1.3 billion people have made this and own this. We are the only country in the world which has its own private digital infrastructure. Extremely to be proud of. We control our own destiny. And if you go back to my previous slide, go back. You all missed the top line. What does it say? Data economy. Data is the new digital economy. Data is the new oil. Why we are doing this? Because we don't want to be colonized all over again. Now, this could have been digital colonization when you're totally dependent on somebody else to do everything that you want to do. Every single transaction somebody else controls. They want to disable you. And a lot of countries have been disabled. Today, if I want to disable, or if let's say we didn't have payment system of our own, Visa, MasterCard, disable India. Done. Your banking system fails. What will happen? Do you think the next, and I'm saying this with a lot of concern, in the new age, and this you have not listened to, my friend, the 19th century, till the 19th century, battles, wars were fought, land and sea. Right? 20th century, early 20th century, air. Later part of 20th century, space. 21st century is cyber. It's data. They say now, we don't need to hack the machine, we need to hack the brain. We don't need to rob the bank, we need to hack the system. That's it, done. Why do I need to do anything physically? I gave an example. All of you use Google Maps, right? Who does not use Google Maps here? All of you do, I do. And we'll be lying if we say we don't. Let's be frank, right? Even if the Google Maps is not on, it's on. You know this? It's giving location attributes to Google. That's how they judge traffic, right? Crowdsourcing of data. Makes tons of money using that, right? But today, Google wants to fool all of us who are coming out of cantonment. Right? Let's say I live in a cantonment. Means 99% I am somewhere related to armed services. Right? I want to fool these armed services next day morning. Right? And they're going from X to Y. And I put them on a wrong, and there's an alert on campus that we need to address. But here, Google Maps is telling me to take the longest route rather than the shortest route. Do you think that's a threat to our national security? Or they all know that we are planning a counteroffensive when 500 armed force personnel gather at 3 a.m. in the morning for a counter or some invasion or some protection or some combing operation. if they all have the cell phones, which they have had in the past in their pockets, do you think somebody knows? Do you think they should know? It's scary. So we have to control our old destiny. And for that, bits and bits, you know, computer science, there's an algorithm called divide and conquer, right? What does it mean? Small problems, solve. So bigger problem is solved. We're building the bits and bytes of India's digital infrastructure, which helps us grow, you know, control our destiny going forward. Payments, identity is one. A lot more needs to be done. A lot more needs to be done. We're still just starting of the journey. But what we have solved are a couple of problems. We can operate at scale. We can operate very frugally. We can operate very locally. And we can literally leapfrog. We have shown this to the world. Right? And now what is happening beautifully is everything that we are building on top, like the example of Ayushman Bharat I gave you, is being built on this infrastructure. We are no longer dependent on somebody else to come and tell us what we need to build and whose infrastructure we should use. So in the interest of time, I gave you this Geo example already. We'll go forward. Another great example in social inclusion. Roughly, what's the population of America, US of A? 300 million, 310, 320 million, plus or minus. That's the number of people who have opened a bank account in India since the last 4 years. These were people who didn't have a bank account before this. You know this? Now, did you know that this could only happen if we had a frugal banking system? Our earlier banking system could not support it. Same reasons as Jio. Paper, too much of transaction cost. It cost a bank. This is the study that I have been part of. McKinsey did it globally. You've heard of McKinsey as a company? So as a McKinsey Knowledge Institute and me, we collaborated and we did a research. It takes, if you walk into a bank and do a transaction, any bank, let's say you have to withdraw 1,000 rupees, and you go and withdraw it at a bank branch, and I'm giving relative numbers, not absolute numbers. It takes 100 rupees if you go to a brick and mortar shop and take out money. You do the same transaction, withdraw 1,000 bucks at an ATM, the cost drops to 18 rupees. Right? Why? Human cost. Anytime, right? Now you do the same transaction on the internet, the cost drops to 1 rupee. You can transfer on the internet, you of course can't withdraw it. But you do the same transaction using UPI, the cost drops to what? Zero. Zero. To make the banks very frugal, to make the banks being able to offer the zero balance accounts, you needed a very frugal, high-tech, low-touch infrastructure. And that is what we built. From enrollment, right? I don't want to go into a banking lesson or fintech lesson, but there's something called a customer acquisition cost, then the customer management cost, right? ARRM, ARM, customer acquisition, retention, monetization, and management. And in that, the biggest piece is the maintenance, the management, the retention, and the acquisition. And if you add all these costs up, our banking would have been unviable. It would have not reached half of India. Today, it reaches almost everybody in India. The zero balance accounts are only possible with high tech, low touch banking. I already gave this numbers, 312 million. These are actual factual numbers. Go ahead. This is the DigiLocker I talked about. This is the other interesting story. What happened also radically in leapfrogging is this. In 2013-14, we had about 170 million, 17 crore internet users in India. It has tripled in 4 years, almost tripled. And what has also happened is, you and me have become the biggest data guzzlers of the world. Absolutely the biggest. We used to consume on average as a country 0.2 GB per month. Today that's a joke. That is consumed on a daily basis. Every Airtel, Jio plan says 1 GB per day. I think Jio is 1.5 GB per day. You know what is the average consumption of data per month today? 9 GB. Who consumes 200 MB over here? Can anybody raise their hand? Who consumes 1 GB over here? No, sir. Your phone is on, always on, it's consuming more than 1 GB by itself. It's pooling. Your WhatsApp is consuming more than that. Cut. Pooling of, when you're pooling, it always keeps consuming a lot of data. 9 GB is an average usage. In fact, the digital natives who discovered internet in the last 2 months, thanks to Jio, last 2 years, sorry, consumes 50 to 60 GB a month. They only watch on Jio. They watch every cricket match, every TV show, everything on Jio only. Jio TV. Right? Have you seen that or not? The biggest source of entertainment is the mobile phone. But along with that, what has happened? So your data cost, your data consumption has gone up 45 times. Your data cost have come down from 269 rupees a GB to 19 rupees a GB. It's become very affordable. Internet has become really affordable because of data cost and two mobile companies assembling, making in India. You know, we have 100 units in India. The big still the cost not anywhere where we want it to be. And again, because of what? Maybe the next slide. Maybe the next one. Sorry, I'm going to skip a few things. Even one more. Yeah, just stop here. This is a new challenge for all of you. While we have created great application, payments, identity infrastructure, this infrastructure, we own zero of it right now. Right? Who owns what? Hardware? Does India make hardware? Do we make firmware? Most of the hardware companies make firmware or ODM suppliers do it. Operating system? Who makes operating system? Microsoft? Android? Linux? Apple? Those are the four common operating systems. Maybe a few variants of it. That's about it. Not a single Indian one. Platforms, we have some. Aadhaar, Identity, India Stack is a platform. Applications, go to the next slide. You'll be surprised. Who are the top 10 applications on any of your phones in India? 8 out of the 10 are not from India. And WhatsApp, Messenger, Facebook, 3 I can bet all of us have over. Who does not have any of them? Anybody brave enough to say they are not in any of them? It's very difficult. So that means they are putting something in their SDK on their phones, on our phones, which they're always listening or monetizing. Always. There is nothing called free lunch. And these apps are free. Remember one thing, and I'll give you this guru mantra, at least my guru mantra. When the product is free, you are the product. Remember this very boldly rest of your life. You understand what I said? You are the product. You are selling yourself a fair value exchange for getting the product free, that application free. Come back. Go backward order, please. Yeah. So I'm going to quickly conclude because you don't want to get bored hearing this. So we'll open it up for some questions. Go back a little bit more. Go back and then we'll leave it. Let's leave it here. What was the government's motivation? Why I call this a platform? Why I call everything that we are creating a platform today? Because no longer these are just apps or portals. Because we are using a platform approach. Platform approach means solving multiple problems using the same code technology. And not limited to one issue. Today, when the Aadhaar project initially started out in 2008-09, it was meant to do one problem. Give benefits to people and directly into their bank accounts. Today it's being used for multitude of things. Nobody ever thought it will be used for KYC. It will be used for health. It will be used for government to give out every single thing. We give out over 433 government welfare schemes are distributed over the direct benefits transfer. That's transparency in governance. That's using technology in governance. It goes directly using UPI into the bank account. You come, you authenticate yourself for a scholarship. All you have to do is authenticate. So you cannot take it twice. No fake person can take it. Nobody else can take it. It's linked to your, you get an SMS on your mobile phone saying you've just authenticated yourself. Goes straight to your bank account, linked to your Aadhaar account. Money transferred to your bank account. Done. No corruption, no duplication, no delay. They used to say, right, justice delayed, justice denied. Governance delayed is governance denied. Now it's real time. Within a day, you get your money. Imagine the impact of it. And what the government's motivation was to spend the 10,000 crores has been served 9 times over. Government has saved 90,000 crores in removing duplicates, fakes, dead people from the system and middlemen. So money has, if I'm a businessman, I've made money 9 times over already. It's free system now. Use it as much as you want. It's an open system. Anybody can use it overhead. You know this? You can build on top of it. The open APIs. Today, who all use it? Google uses it for Google Tej, now called Google Pay. WhatsApp has WhatsApp payments. Flipkart has Phone Pay for payments. DGO has identity. Jio uses the identity platform, KYC. Everybody picks and chooses whatever they want and they use it. Airtel, Vodafone also do their KYC through this, right? Bank accounts are linked to KYC. It's all becoming paperless. Anybody can use it. You can build apps on top of it. You can build ecosystems on top of it. You're not limited to government. And that is the beauty of this infrastructure. It's open infrastructure, open innovation. That's what brings innovation to a country. That's what we have squeezed time frames, both for government. Otherwise, a scheme getting announced in the budget of this year, 1st of February, Ayushman Bharat, PM formally announcing it on 15th of August. And yesterday was what date? 23rd of September. 1 month, 8 days. In India, 38 days to launch, to announce and launch would not be dreamt of. We can dream of doing this at scale because we have the most powerful, frugal, scalable infrastructure anywhere in the world. Anywhere in the world. And I'm proudly, boldly saying this, all of us helped build this, but still only 10% being used. So scale up can go up massively. The same UPI used to do 100,000 transactions. 1 lakh is doing 31 crore, it's not failed. 3 crore Aadhaar authentications every day, 90 crores a month. It's not failing. This is hugely scalable. So the confidence and the trust we have, and don't get me wrong, is it foolproof? Of course not. It's 100%. There is not the software engineering, computer science would fail if there is something called 100%. None of us have any software that we have produced is 100%. We keep adding. That's how we make money, right? Microsoft made Windows in 95. Still, iOS has come to 11 or 12 version. Android is on what version, bhai? 9. Why? Because every time there's a patch, there's a release, there's some patch, there's some new bug they have fixed. They found and fixed. Same thing with us. We keep improving it. It's not fixed in time. We have to keep improving it. Quickly go forward. I just want to talk about one more thing. This is the senior citizens example I give, a dignity of life example, but that's okay. I want to leave it here. India's digital infrastructure, and Aadhaar is symbolic of that, is something which is helping us disrupt almost anything we can think of. Government, I've already talked about. Money, we have talked about. Health, just right now, yesterday, it got telecom, KYC, mobility. Today, he does work in mobility. Your driving license, you're from Maharashtra. Who else is in other parts of India? Your driving license, where are you from? Karnataka. Your driving license is valid everywhere. But you know, if you get challanged in Chennai, in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka doesn't get impacted at all. That's why you drive with impunity, without even having any fear. Whatever happens doesn't make a difference. There's no zero portability, right? Number portability has happened. Driving license portability does not exist. Same thing with payments. On toll bridges, a lot of things need to be disrupted. Offenses, you've heard about the horrific cases of Uber drivers, right? Because nobody could check their background. Because they had one driving license in West Bengal, they did some crime, they threw it away, they came to use another one in Uttar Pradesh, and they're driving in Delhi. No single source of truth. There's a lot of things that we can do. There are a lot of innovations, a lot of disruptions waiting to happen. Health, I talked about. What about skills? We have no national registry of skills. We have no national database of all of you. It's a program, not a software where I can say if I need. Imagine, and again, all of us are overqualified for this, but think about skilling at a lower level. If you want 100,000 jobs to be identified, what training to be done there, what skills available, there is no skills registry in India. And skills are not portable. If somebody comes to you with a certificate written in Assamese, you will not be able to understand it. 99% likelihood you will reject that certificate. That's an official language of India, right? That's a big issue. Skills portability, credit portability. Right? There are many such issues waiting to happen. The good news is we have the infrastructure and we have the innovators. You guys are sitting here. Government can innovate. Government can squeeze time frames of years to months now. I'm sure all of you can, right? And we have the biggest, the most available infrastructure at a very frugal cost. I'm just going to leave the last portion here because you talked about participatory governance. A platform that I represent, MyGov, is again one of the biggest platforms in the world for citizen governance. Nobody does it as big as we do. You heard about the postal banks? India Post launched a postal bank. Guess who suggested that? Or who made the logo for Digital India? How do they do it? This is the biggest platform in the world to connect the citizen to the governance and making sure that their ideas, their policy inputs, their discussions, their suggestions are taken by the government. So no longer people sitting in one room can decide the destiny of this nation. Postal bank was an idea that came out of here. We use advanced analytics to make sure that we take out garbage, but take out and use the right suggestions. We get a lot of hello, hi also, which is okay, which is fun, but the important ones can't be missed out because of that. And when I meant hello, hi, you understand what kind of things it would be. So. But a lot of ideas also. The power of does not live only in Delhi, which I live and reside in. Right? That we need to have a country where 130 crore people can give their inputs. The inputs have to be consumed. We consume that. That's the platform to do that. And on the reverse, to ensure in real time what is happening as the progress of the country is given to the citizens. And we are launching tomorrow a revamped citizen eligibility platform. Anybody can go to the site or through an assisted mode, fill out 8 questions and know which scheme they're eligible for anywhere in the country. There are, I told you about 430 schemes, central and state, out of which 60 schemes are run by the central government, 60 big schemes. Today, do you know you're eligible for which scheme? From tomorrow, you will know. Anybody, you can just answer 7-8 questions, you'll know. We're building a complete rule-based AI engine. But this is all being done. The concept is called Meri Sarkar, Mere Dwar. my government at my doorstep. For the simple reason that we want to make governance very simple, reach every person. And we have the core infrastructure to do it. Right? I will stop if there is anything else, or are we done? We're done. What's the future? Come down to the last slide and leave it there, and then we'll open it up for question answers. Yes, just leave it there. Health, this slide was made on Friday, by the way. So it still says health there, but health has already been disrupted since yesterday. We're doing a lot of things pending, a lot of judicial. 85% of cases in India are land cases. Land titles are not known, right? Can we link it? Can we use blockchain to make sure that land is not misused, misappropriated? A lot of future. Health, personalized. Education, personalized. The amount of metadata that we produce from health will be amazing. We can predict outbreaks. We can predict supply of medicine. We are starting so many new cycles that we have not imagined before. And the world has not imagined, by the way. Right? The world has also not imagined. India leads in this. The world looks up to India on this, by the way. Because everywhere else, they look up to Silicon Valley. Or they look up to a city called Shenzhen in China. Here, we don't look up to anybody. We solve it ourselves. We control that. And that's the reason I was talking about building our own infrastructure, controlling our own destiny. Learning, health, land titles, judicial processes. These are some I have identified. Mobility. A lot of things need to be done. So we're starting an innovation cycle like the world has never seen before. The fourth industrial revolution. Right? That is really the fourth industrial revolution. Convergence. Good news is India is well poised. Very good news is we have the capacity, both digital and human. We produce the highest number of engineers in the world. Better do it. When I graduated in 92, India used to produce 20,000 engineers. You know what is the number of engineers that got produced this year? Huh? Something close to that. 8 lakh engineers. So, good or bad, we produce 8 lakh engineers. Like it or not. Some of them are good. And some of them are sitting in this room. Most of them are sitting in this room. So you better solve some of these problems. Lot of data. When you have data, you can do AI. When you have, only when you have a lot of data, you can crunch numbers, make sense out of it. And you can control a lot of things. Some problems we've solved, some we need to solve. A lot of people are working on this, the other platform, the firmware, chip design, operating system levels. But we need a lot more efforts, a lot more scale. Remember, Harry Page, were students. Google has become Google in 20 years. Right? This business cycles have squeezed like crazy. Alibaba has become Alibaba in 15 years. From a school teacher, Jack Ma, to one of the richest people on the planet. Dream it would take 50 years to produce companies of that scale. Today the fact is 7 to 10 years. You can produce companies, you can produce operating systems, you can produce groundbreaking technology. And India has shown it. UPI is the fastest. We have broken Moore's law. Nowhere else. Right. So I leave it. Yes, sir. Identify yourself. Thank you. portable completely. Bimlunduji, right? What is your question? Hundred percent possible. Now you are coming. See, you asked two different questions. Is it possible? Yes. What are the challenges? Ask your all local MLAs. No, I'm kidding. Challenges are there. Legislative process. You have to break the legislative process and have a uniform code for that. Attempts are being made. It's in the right direction because it's a state subject. But we have to come uniformly on that. GST is a success. Health is a success. Health has just been rolled out. Majority of the states have signed up. So we'll have to see both of that. GST, because they get money, they have come on. This one is also really important. Believe me, for safety of our citizens, this is going to be very important. It has to be looked that way. Yes. Oh, how can we regulate? Do we want to regulate them or do we want to compete with them? No, first question is, do we want to regulate them or compete with them? So number one, we should compete with them. See, again, this is, pardon? Let me give my thoughts. It's a democracy, right? You have an opinion, I have an opinion. The question really is, regulation has really not worked anywhere in the world. It's killed innovation more often than less. Innovation happens in the wedges, in the gray spaces of regulation. And regulation cannot keep pace with technology. You'll regulate one, something else will happen, right? Compete, right? Maybe do a light touch regulation, but not regulation on Uber, regulation on verification, right? Regulation on driver certification, regulation on data. That regulation could be there. Not on the business model of Uber, but on the processes that are around it. And that will apply equally to everybody. That means the driver should be verified, right? Two, cars should have authenticity, should have, you know, legal backing. Today there is no liability. If you get hit by a Uber driver, Uber has no liability. It is a driver who has a liability. Uber is just a platform. Right? Three, data. How do you take data? What data you take and how do you use it? That's the biggest issue. You know, Uber takes your data and monetizes it against you. Do you know this? The ladies in the room, do you know this? If both of you book Uber right now, it might give you a higher price than him because you have a higher need. If you go to a posh area, they charge you higher fees. If you are low on battery, they can charge you a higher fees because you have urgency. You don't want to wait 2-3 times. That's using algorithms to use your data to gamify you. That can be controlled. Yes.
Sir, Aadhaar is helping the health sector and banking, but in that slide, the one sector is food. How Aadhaar helps the food?
PDS, public delivery systems, right? You need to make sure that there is food on the plate. Yesterday, people could not get, the PDS systems would fail. Now we have implemented mostly ePDS systems. They are Aadhaar based. And this is the starting of it. I'm not saying it is the end of it. I said this is the possibilities. There are possibilities from starting till the end. Land titles. If you give the farmer more right over their land, better credit, farmer can have better livelihood. Farmer has a better livelihood, you get better food. Don't think of food as just one item. It's a food chain. Starting from the land, growing, giving the credit to the farmer, tilling, selling, you buying it, distributing PDS, consuming it. The
whole cycle needs to be disrupted. And credit is a very big problem for farmers. I gave you example of Tencent. Right? Tencent owns WeChat. You know what else they do? How does Tencent make money?
Payments.
How? Means what? Good, you're right in the right direction. WeChat also has a bank, by the way, which is like a wallet. You know what is the cash reserves they have? $125 billion at last count. Free money. They can give out credit overnight, 3 days, 5 days, 10 days. They give it to the merchants. They give it to farmers. So funding the unfunded. Farmers get better, cheaper loans because otherwise the Mahajans charge them very high. You can give them better credit because of identity, because of payment system. You're helping the farmer, you're putting more food into India's food bowl. There are a lot of implications, my friend. Don't think unilaterally. India is a big country, there are a lot of diversity, 22 different languages. A lot of things can be done. We are just at the starting tip of this.
So,
please keep time, guys, whosoever is the organizer. So, just keep time. As I told you, my flight is at 9:05. So, I need to be at the airport by 8 o'clock. That's my constraint. 10 more minutes? Okay, that means a couple of 3-4 more questions. Yes. Who has the mic? Okay, please.
So my question is twofold. I'll make it brief. One is that on various platforms, including social media, we see a huge war waged against Aadhaar. And the primary concern for those people, assuming that their concern is genuine, is that Aadhaar is susceptible to some data attack or leakage. That is one thing. And the second is, if Aadhaar is, Aadhaar as in the Digital India, the complete platform itself. So if it is such a potent platform, then why aren't other, even private companies making a large use of it? So the question would be that why are we in general bad at PR? Why do many people not know about these things?
That's a good question. Amog, right?
Yes, sir.
Please sit. First question. We are a democracy, my friend. Difference of opinions should happen. Sometimes we have to agree to disagree. That's what I think the Aadhaar people who are all genuinely, who are you calling out on social media, have concerns. And I started with that. Some of the concerns are genuine. Some improvements have happened because of genuine concerns.
So when they want to close the whole system down,
see, world is not black or white any longer. If there is mistakes, let's solve it. As simple as that. But if you don't accept there are mistakes, that is also wrong. Right? There is no that, okay, I am 100% correct, you are 100% wrong. So both sides have to understand the same thing. You understand? But sometimes because you see a conversation which is only one way, you think that's the case. No. It's both ways. We've made a lot of improvements. While it may look like criticism, constructive criticism is always welcome. That's what the public platform like MyGov is. I get so much of constructive criticism and we implement it. Feedback is important. In a healthy democracy, feedback is important. Second part, why are private companies not using it? Private companies are lining up to use it. We have to deny access sometimes. Which private company is not using it? Which bank is not using it? Which telco is not using it? You give me one. WhatsApp is dying to launch its payment platform in India, which is in the beta phase, 1 million users already. Google has long Google Pay. Which company is not using it? We are giving nightmares to many companies. That's different also. You can imagine which companies this will be giving nightmares to. So think about it. Maybe on the way out, we'll talk about which are the companies which we would be giving nightmares to. Which company is not using it? Your third point taken, a lot more needs to be talked about. Maybe first step in the right direction from me. We talk about it over here. You should spread. What else? Yes.
Sir, how can startups and companies use the data that you are generating and use it for analytics or AI or something?
Very good question. We are coming out, India is coming out with one of the most forward-looking regulation or acts called data empowerment. Watch the words very carefully. Data empowerment and protection architecture. It empowers as well as protects. Now, if I want credit, today, if I want to ask a bank for a credit card, what do? I give my bank statements. If I want to ask for a visa, what do? I give my bank accounts. I give all the paper documents. I cannot limit till what time can you use it, not use it. You can use it forever. You can, you know, with this, I can make access. If you want to give me credit, for the next 48 hours, I'll give you access to my digital footprint. Whatever I want to give access to, it's like checkboxes. You can access it for, let's say, whatever time, and make a decision and get back to me. So that architecture is being made. Now all, it's again fair game. Whosoever can access. Health, same thing. As long as the user owns the data and gives consent, if you go back, where is Nipun? Go back to that India Stack slide, the second or third slide. The top layer is very important. And I did mention it, but I didn't know there will be a question. So thank you for asking that. See the first thing, the very first thing. What is it written there? Consent layer. Provides a modern privacy data sharing framework. I didn't write it right now. It was always written. It's part of the architecture. The data becomes really the new oil. But with the right consent. Today, are you giving consent? Do you even know what data you're sharing with Facebook and Google? You actually don't know. I also don't. Okay, let me ask this question before we all split. You know, what is a hot mic? Do you know you can be hot mic'd? Who can do it? Which product on your phone can do it? Most of the apps can do it. And most of the apps do it in the garb of something or the other. And they actually say that they've taken your permission, by the way. You just don't know about it. Be very careful. I'm not trying to do scaremongering, but I'm saying you give permissions without knowing what you do. And you includes me also. Quick, yes, 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 yes. Oh, our terms of conditions have changed. Do you ever read? Somewhere it would say, oh, we'll pick up, randomly pick up location and voice samples because we want to build our AI system. They do that. Randomly they'll start picking up voice samples. There's a case going on in the US. By the way, real case, you do a Google search, Alexa. It's called the Alexa murder case. So supposedly, you know Alexa, right? Alexa heard supposedly a murder plot. Now, who does that data belong to? Does it belong to Alexa? Or does it belong to the consumer? And if it belongs to the consumer, it's my amendment. What amendment is that? Constitutional amendment. The First Amendment, right? Privacy. It's a very interesting question. So, let's see what happens.
And sir, can Aadhaar be used for voting in the future?
I didn't even come to the democratization of Aadhaar. Can it be used for voting? Of course it can be. Will it be used for voting? Our legislation has to decide that. The question can and will are two different questions, my friend. Will really requires will. Political will is really required. We have experimented as a country and we found you can remove a lot of duplicates. Again, voting lists also have the same problems. I registered once in X city and then I moved to a Y city. The X also has it, the Y also has it. Need to remove somewhere. Let's see what happens. But you understand what I'm saying? Can and will, they're two different things. Should also is a third part of it. Aadhaar doesn't have any data. Aadhaar only has a biometric system of yes and no. That data belongs to you. Only you can access the data through your authentication. Data belongs to you. Should belong to you. And does belong to you. Okay? Pardon? Which one? DigiLocker? Authentication? Or? Oh, there's an app. The DigiLocker app or a website. You actually don't know, but you all have something or the other stored there. Can we stop now? Sorry, can we stop now? Otherwise, I am around. We can go out, ask something else. Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
I now request EML student head Kushal Reddy to felicitate the speaker with a memento as a token of our appreciation. I humbly request the speaker to sign the yearbook, and I request the audience not to leave the hall until the speaker has left. I wish to express our heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Arvind Gupta for his insightful lecture. Sir, it has been an honor hosting you here today, and I'm sure the audience has gathered a lot of knowledge and inspiration from your talk. I also wish to thank the audience who have contributed towards making this a success.